First of all, I would like to thank the IOA PGP team headed by Rajagopalan sir for giving me this opportunity to share some of my views regarding this Springell Shoal. The topic as such, it is a very rare thing. It is very rarely asked in the exam, especially in the practical exam. In my past 15 to 20 years of experience, I have only seen it being kept twice or thrice in the PG exams. So usually it will be a child like this coming through with this deformity. So this is an elevated scapula. This is often called as a congenital elevation scapula. But this term is a misnomer because it is a failure of scapula to descend from the level of C4 to its normal position. The normal position of the scapula is between T2 and T7. It is the commonest congenital anomaly occurring in the shoulder girdle. A little bit regarding the embryology, the development of the scapula starts between 4th and the 8th week of gestation, that is intrauterine life. It is located at the level of the 4th cervical vertebra. The scapula descends down by the 12th week of intrauterine life to its normal position, which I have already mentioned, between T2 and T7. The failure of this descent leads to a hypoplastic and elevated scapula. So what causes this? Nobody knows. Various theories are there. One is a vascular lesions arising from the subclavian artery distribution, leading on to a failure of descent. Springell himself thought that it is due to increased amniotic fluid pressure. And autosomal dominant inheritance have been reported. But most of these cases which we see are sporadic cases. Now, regarding the history of Springell shoulder, it was first reported in 1868 by Eulenburg in Germany. And it is named after a letter by Otto Gerhard Karl Springer in 1891. Actually, in the paper, it was Springell and Kollinger who described the lesion, and Kollinger gave the name of his elder Springell. The main classification system came in 1972, years after that, by Cavendish. So what is the pathoanatomy? It is just the continuation of the fetal form of the scapula. It is a small and deformed scapula. There is a horizontal diameter of the scapula exceeds the vertical diameter. Third, anterior curving of the supraspinous portion. Prolongation of the supromedial scapular angle. The omovertebral bar is seen in around up to 50% of cases. Then the costovertebral defects, that is vertebral defects like congenital scoliosis and costal defects like refusion, all these are commonly seen. Omovertebral bone in 20 to 50% of cases, you can see it here. So it is a chondrovocious structure. It is rhomboid or trapezoidal in shape. It connects the supromedial border of the scapula with the spinous process, lamina, or the transverse process of the cervical vertebra between C4 and C7. So it is attached to the spine and it is attached to the supromedial border. Always there may not be a continuation. Some part of it is fibrous or some part of it may be cartilaginous. And there may be a joint in between these two. It is best visualized in the lateral and the oblique X-ray. So scapular rotation is an important part. If the scapula just descends like this as in a normal scapula, there will not be any rotation. But if there is a medial tether, you can understand what is going to happen. If it is tethering, it starts rotating and this causes restriction of abduction. Tethering superiorly will cause just an elevation of the scapula without any rotation. So it is the medial tethering that is responsible for rotation of the scapula, which actually this is wrong. It rotates in this direction, in the reverse direction, and therefore the glenoid will be facing downwards. This leads to the restriction in the rotation. What is the clinical problem which the child comes to you? The child comes to you usually with a cosmetic problem. one side, there is asymmetry of the shoulder, and one shoulder is at a higher level. Or they may come with a functional problem. What is the functional problem? It is the restriction of shoulder abduction, and very rarely they will come with pain. What causes restriction of shoulder abduction? One is the forward, I have already said, the superior angle of the scapula is bent forwards over the apex of the thorax. Second, the inferior pole of the scapula is medially rotated, which I have already shown, with the glenoid facing caudally. Then some of the muscles are weakened, absent, and provide insufficient power of shoulder abduction. And the fourth is the omovertebral bone. These are the four causes by which cause restriction of movement of the shoulder. So the presentation is cosmetic or functional. Functional restriction of abduction. I have already mentioned what causes the restriction of abduction. Now coming to other clinical features. Usually, even though it is a congenital anomaly, it is not usually detected at birth, even if it is a mild lesion. It is usually detected in 1 to 2 years of age. It is common in females in the ratio 3:1. More on the left side, the reason is unknown. It can be bilateral. And unilateral lesions produce more cosmetically unacceptable, While bilateral lesions are more cosmetically acceptable, but functionally disabling. On the general examination of the child, always look for a short neck, because these Sprengel shoulder is associated with several other problems, like Klippel field anomaly. Therefore, a short neck may be there. There may be a low hairline. There may be webbing of the neck. There may be torticollis. Usually, the neck will be tilted towards the side of the Sprengel shoulder. There may be a dorsal scoliosis or a lower cervical scoliosis, which may be congenital scoliosis. There may be costal asymmetry, that is asymmetry of the thorax. There may be facial asymmetry, plagiocephaly. There may be spinal dysraphism. This spinal dysraphism may be at a lower level. In the lower lumbar spine also, you can see lesions like diastomatomalia, which has been reported. In the local examination, always look for the contour and the symmetry of the shoulder. By inspection itself, you can find that the shoulder is asymmetric and the contour is different. Then you look at the position and the size and the orientation of the scapula, whether there is any scapular rotation. Then the scapular hypoplasia will be there. Scapula will be at a higher level and scapula may be rotated. This is often described as a shear lesion. Scapular hypoplasia, elevation and rotation. Omovertebral bone may be palpable. If you palpate in this area, you may be able to feel a bony resistance. Wasting of the muscle is not very common, but may be seen. But congenital absence of some muscles like pectoralis major may be seen when it is associated with Pollen syndrome. And usually there will be some hypoplasia of the whole of the upper limb. So you don't forget to take measurements of the upper limb and compare with that of the opposite side. Now you look at the movements. There will be restriction of movement. Here you find there is restriction of movements, but reasonable amount of movements are usually seen. Active and passive movements are usually the same. And another thing is the scapular elevation sign, which will come to in the next slide, it will be negative. And normal glenohumeral movements will be there. And there will be severely restricted scapulothoracic movement because the scapula is rotated and it is not moving. So 30% of the movement is contributed by the scapulothoracic joint. That will be affected. But the glenohumeral joint is usually having reasonable range of movements. The scapular elevation sign is the prominence of the scapula change with various movements of the shoulder. This you might have seen in cases of birth brachial plexus palsies. You might have seen the so-called putty sign. The subscapularis, when it is contracted and if you externally rotate, the scapula becomes prominent. When you externally rotate and abduct the shoulder, if the contracted muscles are teres major and latissimus dorsi, again the scapula becomes prominent. If the pectoralis major is contracted, pectoralis major is an adductor, Therefore, if you abduct the arm, the scapula becomes prominent. Teres minor and infraspinates are external rotators. So if they are contracted, the opposite movement, the scapula will become prominent and elevated. And supraspinatus, if you abduct it, again, the scapula becomes prominent. So this scapular elevation sign usually will be negative. I have concentrated on this because if you get a shoulder case where the diagnosis may be a little different, that is a brachial plexus birth palsy, these signs may be positive. You look for other anomalies. Vertebral anomalies, usually don't forget to look at the back for a spina bifida or a scoliosis, which may be due to a formation defect or a segmentation defect. Look at the rib cage, whether there is any asymmetry. There may be rib anomalies which can only be seen in X-rays. Muscles may be hypoplastic, fibrotic, and absent. The usual ones are the trapezius, rhomboides, levator scapulae. But other muscles like serrated anterior, pectoralis major, all these muscles may be hypoplastic or fibrotic. Associated anomalies in the spinal cord may be seen. And usual thing is diastematomalia, which has been reported initially by Von Basen, and it is commonly seen. The tethered cord syndrome is another association. There may be cleft palate and lips, camptodactyly, and renal and agenesis and pulmonary problems. So many anomalies may be seen. Cardiovascular problems may be seen. So a systemic examination again is important. There are several associated syndromes. If you look at the test books, there is a lot of syndromes reported. But the common ones are the Klippel field, which is a triad of cervical vertebral body fusion, low hairline, and the short leg with limited range of movement of the neck. Pollen syndrome, which I have already said, absence of pectoralis major along with syndactyly. Or water syndrome, the vertebral anal, tracheoesophageal, and renal anomalies, which is commonly associated with the radial cleft hand. And Charcot-Levin syndrome, it is nothing but a spondylocostal dysostosis, which has occasionally been reported. There has been a report from KMC Manipal also. It shows multiple vertebral segmentation defects and anomalies. Now coming to the classification, Cavendish classification is a clinical classification, which tells you how much the shoulder is at a higher level compared to normal. Grade one means shoulder joints are at level and deformity is not visible when dressed, or a slight elevation may be seen. Scapula may be elevated, but the shoulder is at the same level. Shoulder joints are at level. The deformity is visible when dressed as a lump in the web of the neck. There is no elevation of the shoulder as such, but only the scapula is elevated. Grade three is shoulder joint is elevated 2 to 5 centimeters and deformity is easily visible. And grade four is the severest variety, where the superior angle may be at the level of the occiput, much higher with the webbing of the neck and short neck. Investigations, X-ray alone is necessary to make the diagnosis. And here you can see both the elevated and broadened scapula, a rotated scapula along with the omovertebral bone. Always don't forget to look at the omovertebral bone and look at the whatever spine. Spine is seen, you look for any anomalies. In the rib also, you look for anomalies. 3D CT, again, helps you to find out the scapular shape and the omovertebral pad. When you take a 3D CT, you will be able to see it very well. This is the bar which you are seeing here, which is clearly visible here. What's the role of MRI? In some fibrous and cartilaginous omovertebral bar can be seen. But the main thing is, you have to do a screening of the spine to look for spinal dysraphism, especially diastematomalia, which is seen at a lower level. Radiological classification has been described. And again, it is not of much importance. It just shows how much the scapula is elevated. Grade one means the supramedial angle lower than T2, but above T4. Grade two means supramedial angle between C5 and T2. And grade three, it is above C5. This indicates just the severity of the elevation of the scapula. Now, differential diagnosis, actually in a severe case of a springle shoulder, there is no differential diagnosis. You can make, it is a spotter and you can make, easily make the diagnosis. But In mild cases, you have to exclude brachial plexus, birth palsy, deltoid contracture, infantile hemiplegia, and osteochondromas of the scapula. In brachial plexus birth palsy, there will be history of difficult labor and shoulder dystocia, history of flaccid paralysis after birth, shear, that is deformity, scapular hypoplasia, elevation and rotation may be seen. The passive movements will be more than active movements because of muscle weakness. The scapular thoracic movements are unaffected, while in the case of the springle shoulder, it is the scapulothoracic movement that is affected. And scapular elevation sign, which is negative, becomes positive here. It is positive in brachial plexus palsy, while it will be negative in springle shoulder. And muscle weakness is more prominent in brachial plexus palsy. The other diagnosis, which is rare nowadays, is the deltoid fibrosis. Usually it is due to injections given onto the deltoid. So it produces scapular malrotation. The scapular elevation sign is positive. It's usually, since the deltoid is the abductor, when you adduct the arm, the scapula becomes prominent. That is how you diagnose that, and you will be able to feel the fibrotic band also. The scapulothoracic movement, again, is not much affected here. Infantile hemiplegia like cerebral palsy, yeah, very rarely mimic this. You can look at the typical history of prenatal problems, prematurity, low birth weight, neonatal asphyxia, convulsion, all this. Then shoulder is adducted and internally rotated. Internal rotators and adductors are spastic. Abduction and external rotation movements are limited, and lower limb involvement may also be seen. A more common differential diagnosis may be an osteochondroma underneath the scapula. Here, it is usually seen in cases of hereditary multiple exostosis, so the family history may be present. There is no shear deformity. The scapula is of normal size, shape, and it is not rotated. Active and passive ranges of movements are the same, unlike in the case of birth brachial plexus palsy. Scapular elevation sign is again negative, and you will be able to feel the bony mass on the proximal humerus or the scapula. Now, regarding the treatment, years back when I was doing my post-graduation, at that time, there was one Barbados fast powder called Gladstone Small. And seeing at the picture, it appears as if he was having a bilateral springle shoulder. So usually during the discussions, the consultant used to tell us, so if Gladstone Small can become a fast bowler, what's the need of doing surgical treatment for this condition? So surgical treatment is rarely indicated. But if there is a severe cosmetic deformity or a severe functional deformity that is limiting abduction of the shoulder, definitely there is an indication for doing surgical treatment. Ideal time, it is usually done between 3 to 6 years of age. Most of the reports say that it should be done during this period. But Tashrian, in his book, says it can be done at 6 months. But there are several others, including from India, who are doing this at even in older children. So indication, the functional problem, cosmetic problem, usually for Cavendish 3 and 4. The goal of surgery is to, for cosmetic and functional improvement. Associated abnormalities such as torticollis and congenital scoliosis limit the amount of correction. Bilateral deformities and grade 1 deformity usually do not need surgical treatment. Patients with grade 4 deformities should be offered a guarded prognosis because the scapula is lying at a very high level, and therefore bringing it down may cause nerve palsies, and you will not be able to bring to the normal level, but you may be able to bring down to a substantially at a lower level. The surgery may be avoided in patients with short neck and concomitant grade 4 deformity. What surgery will we do? In mild lesions, these are the two surgical procedures that can be done. There is excision of the omovertebral bone and excision of the supramedial angle of the angle and the omovertebral bone. These surgeries can be done, and it improves the cosmosis. And when the omovertebral bone is removed, it improves the range of abduction also. So in mild cases, you can get away with this. The other method is scapular transplantation at a lower level. That is two procedures that have been described are the Woodward procedure and the Green procedure. I don't think at the postgraduate level you need to know a lot about these surgical procedures, because these are done only by a few surgeons in the specialized centers, not routinely done in all the hospitals. Other options are subtotal scapulectomy and scapular osteotomies. So you just need to remember this, and you to know a few the principles of scapular transplantation. So the basic difference between the Green procedure and the Woodward procedure is that Green erases the muscle from the insertion of the scapula, while in the Woodward procedure, it is erased from the origin. The steps are one, osteotomy of the clavicle. In severe lesions, you do a morselization of the clavicle, that is, cut the clavicle into multiple pieces and put it back in the periosteal sleeve. With this reduces the incidence of brachial plexus palsy. You detach the trapezius from the insertion to the spine of the scapula, erase latissimus dorsi, then you detach levator scapula and rhomboida. So all the muscles attaching onto the scapula apart from the lateral border are now erased. Then you elevate the scapula and detach serratus anterior if required. Now you bring the scapula to a lower level and attach it to the ribs, and then you repair the muscles. In the Woodward procedure, you erase the muscle from the origin and again detach the muscles, trapezius, rhomboidus, levator scapulae, remove the omovertebral bone. The prominent bony portion can also be excised, that is, the supramedial portion can also be removed. The scapula is pulled downwards and muscles are reattached at a distal level. And these surgeries are not without complications. Brachial plexus palsy have been reported, and this can be reduced by a generous clavicular osteotomy or clavicular morselization. Nerve injuries like injuries to the dorsal scapular nerve, spinal accessory nerve, and suprascapular nerve have been reported. And scapular winging, even after surgical problem, you have brought the scapula down, but it produces winging. That again becomes a cosmetic problem. Another cosmetic problem that is associated with this is keloid formation. These are the common surgical procedures and the problems associated with that. And as I've already said, you need to do, you as postgraduates, you need to know only the principles of treatment. As in a mild lesion with omovertebral bone, you just remove the bone. If there is a cosmetically supramedial border is prominent, you excise that. In severe lesions, that is Cavendish 3 and 4, after explaining the risk to the patient, if you are working in a center where this is routinely done, you can try for bringing the scapula down. Thank you very much.